and you should get a sign up. I think it may even say orderly. Okay, so I'm going to do the introductions as I would start, so it's all recorded. My name is Zoe Turner. I'm a data scientist at Nottinghamshire Healthcare Trust, which covers Nottingham and Nottinghamshire and a few other areas. My trust offers mental health and general health services to the population. And I've been learning R because it never really stops, for about 3 years. My first introduction to R was coming to the NHS-R community, 3-day course as it was then, and now I run it in 1 day. But that's thanks to a lot of helpful people who did all the slides and things. So welcome everybody. We should all be set up both in the cloud and on the laptops and PCs as people prefer. And if anybody has any issues as we go along, please do say about those in terms of the technical difficulties that we face with things like this being Zoom or the PCs or the cloud, because these things do happen. So at the beginning of our session, when we first met up, a poll went out and we've had lots of people reply to them. There's a lot of people here, so we can't do main introductions, but I'll just read through what people are doing. It looks like 50-50 almost, well, 57%, if we're going to be accurate, are going to use the cloud today. We choose to use the cloud just to sort of reassure people in that everything is set up and we can bypass a lot of the variances that we have with people's laptops, permissions, packages availability, how up to date your R and RStudio is, because that can cause some issues. But we still are very flexible. I'm quite flexible because at some point, hopefully, you'll go back to your PCs and use them. So we've got 43% on there who are using their own laptop. Organisations, we've got 43% who are from trusts, 4% from CCGs. I'm reading out percentages, this probably means very little. Local authorities here, university, other government, other health and social care, and other. And you're very welcome. And I think this is something that's said repeatedly through NHSR community. We call it the NHSR, but it's NHS plus, and it's also R plus. So we use lots of tools as analysts, and we're also incredibly keen to work with colleagues and people interested in healthcare in other areas. So you're very welcome. Thank you for coming along. Main roles is also very interesting. We've got 39% analysts, 13% clinicians, 4% academic, some researchers, 17%, and other, which is always a fascinating category group in these things, 26%, which is not unsubstantial, but it's a kind of catch-all for lots of people. What do you use to analyze? Now, this helps me sort of relate things back, and a lot of people, 78% of people use Excel, which is not unsurprising. It's everywhere, it's very available, and it's where we all often start with our data analysis. 30%-ish SQL users. We've already got some R users, which is fantastic. So, you know, if I've missed something, if you know a little secret or a little kind of catch, tip it, that's a new word, tips and tricks, please do share them. Power BI, Clicks, Tableau, and other. So there's a lot of dashboards that are used within our skill sets here. Have you any experiences of R? We have a few people who are intermediate, so I feel free to share your knowledge as well. This is great for me to learn. As I say, I'm always R so broad. We're always learning. Novices, 52%, and never used R at all, 39%, which is fantastic. So welcome, everybody. It's just right for what we require, and I'm going to try and share my screen while talking, which is multitasking. And hopefully you can see my screen. So just introducing myself, I've done that. This is the agenda. It's a very loose agenda. It was based on when we were in person. Things are very different when you are virtual. I'm going to try and take some breaks regularly, even if it's just a couple of minutes to get up, stand and move around. If you need a break, please feel free to take that yourself anytime during this course session. But also just to say, can I have lunch, for example, because it's very easy to get carried away. And I've got Annie on standby as well here. I forgot to introduce you, Annie. Annie's going to be helping me today, checking the chat, reminding me to take a break, and being here just to help out. Annie's got some great experiences with R, and I'll let you introduce yourself briefly, if that's okay, Annie.
Oh, thank you so much, Zoe. I'm very happy to be here to help. Great session. My name is Annie. I'm an epidemiology programmer, long job title. But yes, I use R in my work every day. automating reports and building dashboards and shiny apps and that kind of stuff. So a lot that you can do with R. It's very powerful. So happy to help people out.
Thank you so much for helping today as well. Annie's been doing her own courses as well. So we've been running them and hopefully we'll run some more. We're here on a volunteer basis, which people have heard before we started recording. So the trainers are volunteers who are analysts or epidemiologists, programmers, who are also training fellow colleagues and other people in other organisations, because we want I certainly want as many people to experience the joy and enthusiasm of R and get over that initial hurdle of learning something new, because that can be quite difficult. So we've got various sessions throughout the day, quite loosely done, but hopefully we'll finish by about 4:30, usually it's around 4:30. The course aims are to show you really in this course the possibilities. It's a really broad subject. You can specialize in many different areas, but I want to kind of get people started, because that's always a difficult bit. Give you a feel of how it works, where you can go for information, what's the potential in it, and to show you enough to get you started, beginning teaching yourself or knowing where to get some help from us as the community. And I'll share some of those links with you. Those who are on the cloud, you might see that already. I'll show you where to find the link to the Slack group that we have, where people will be clamoring to help you with things. We've lots of free resources in R. It's a very great and wonderful community. I'm going to start by just sort of showing a few of the potential bits within R. So it's kind of gone dark because I've got this graphic sign up here. But I've updated this since I first did the course 3 years ago, because a lot of the charts that came out through the COVID period that we're still kind of living in, 2020 particularly, there were some wonderful visual aids and visual interpretations of what was happening through the pandemic, which I've referenced here. And these slides are available through our website on NHS-R GitHub, but also there are links to other people's. So this is from Colin Angus, who does a lot of graphical work for, I couldn't work out whether it's for himself or for public health, but he releases all the code so we can use this ourselves. So this is a timeline for COVID-19 cases in English local authorities. This represents the first wave. Things have kind of progressed since there, but the code is really very clear. And I have used his heat map code for something more simple in my own area. This was for the original course that I did. I couldn't find the code for this or the original blog. It's no longer available, but the graphical visualization is really useful. It's an interpretation of the usage of, this was pre-pandemic, bicycle usages in London. So the thicker the road, the more used those bicycles are. So you can use R for visual, geospatial visualizations. I referenced this with Colin Angus's GitHub and sharing his code for those charts. There's a lot of collaboration expectation or reproducibility within R, which makes it really fascinating and useful that you can see something that you like that somebody else has done, and invariably they will have shared that code, and then we can then use that ourselves, bits of it, and hope. And one of the things here that's an example is R Markdown. So one of the tremendously powerful, and we will kind of only touch upon it in this course, and I never feel like I do it enough justice, but there are other workshops this week. They are fully booked, unfortunately, but they will be recorded like this one, I think, that will be available in YouTube for R Markdown. So other colleagues are doing courses or developing courses in R Markdown. It's a very powerful way of combining text, visualizations, and code all together, so that you can do a report that you can reproduce multiple times, which is fantastic when you're doing things like this, where you're combining nearly 2000 unique graphics according to the organization that the report relates to, unique tables, and then the output can be in something that's very familiar for users like PowerPoint or accessing, as we will probably do, through HTML, which just makes it very accessible. It's a very powerful, as I say. We've also got this other thing that you may have also heard about called Shiny Apps. We won't be covering that one today, but it's just to show the potential of where you can take it to. So it's a little bit similar to, I suppose, and I haven't used this myself, the Clicks and the Tableaus and the Power BI dashboard solutions. This is a particular one that came from the Commissioning Strategy Unit, which is also the group that, or the organization that supports NHS-R community, for their mental health surge modeling. So if I click on that, you'll see it load it can be a bit slow sometimes because these they just are when they load. And I haven't used this myself, but it's got a lot of potential for the parameters that you can select to see what the potential mental health surge will be. The bit that I looked at, and I should be more interested because I deal with data that's mental health data, I think those who are clinically minded or working within mental health will recognize things like IAPT and general practice being one of the quite substantial potential uses. I've just clicked randomly and these two always come up quite high. That's all available, all the code, and if you require any of the methodology in the background, again, those individuals who've contributed to this are part of the NHS-R community. So they are available and keen to talk in places like our NHS-R Slack group. Another group, I'll say, which is more public health orientated, is Trafford Data Lab, who do a lot of visualizations that they've released all the code for, including the public health data, because it's all public data. And I've quite liked their color scheme. So I've used a lot of their code to apply to things like the color formation here. I've not replicated their Shiny apps. This is a Shiny app I'm going into, but you can see these three bits of information. This is particularly for Trafford, but you can also, this is kind of nice that you can look for other local authorities. So this is really lovely to emulate or to refer to, because they release all their data. The data's released is their code methodology. And this particular thing in the slide is their Twitter dash. So if you are at all interested in looking at tweets and when your organization is mentioned for various reasons, there's some code behind that if you look for the GitHub and then find things. And they write things really clearly. They use what we're going to use today as well in terms of the packages, ggplot2 and dplyr. There are lots of analysts here. There was a substantial number who use SQL. And one of the things that we may touch upon, but there's certainly some work that's been done by other colleagues within the community on connecting SQL data into R. So we're going to put that right at the very end, and we may not cover that. But again, this is a webinar that's been done by one of the people who's developed the slides, which are also available, but as I say, I might not cover. Chris Maney and his colleague Emily have worked on some things for connecting into SQL to try that, getting SQL connected into R. This course today, we're going to cover more basic. We're going to look at getting CSV files in, but you can get any kind of data into R and then work with it within R. And I know that when I first started, that was one of the things I was quite keen to get started with, to get my data from my data warehouse into R to do things with it. That's supposed to move, but it doesn't move, but that's okay because it's stuck on NHSR community. I wanted to reinforce the inclusivity of our community, and ours is a small subset of a larger community, which is not working with the links. Let me see if I can force it. There we go. Oh, there we go. It just ran out of things. Our Ladies Global is, as it says in the title, global. It's started predominantly, I think, for trying to encourage people who are not normally included within programming communities to give them a voice and a space to share what they've worked on and their methodologies, and to just feel comfortable in asking questions. There's minorities in R as well. That's quite a new one. I think that started only a couple of years ago. Again, I'm putting up here the Twitter accounts, and then there's our own as well. So we have the NHSR Twitter account, but we've also got, and I've said this a few times, I'm on repeat at the moment, you can find us all in the NHSR Slack group. That's where we congregate. And we've all got that sense of helping everybody as best we can, but giving a voice to those who may not feel like they have the space. It can be quite intimidating, let's just say, in some of these technology communities. And I've always found it to be very inclusive and supportive within the R community. One of the things I will also say on this philosophy, which also harks back to inclusivity, no question is a stupid question. No question is a silly question. In fact, they're probably the best questions. So that is my thing. I post often sometimes a Slack question, Slack rather than say some other places, and then answer it myself. And I feel that that's okay because I'm just sharing my knowledge. We don't know everything. So there is no stupid question. And that is also the course philosophy. There are no stupid questions. It's also quite informal. I know we're being recorded, but people can put things in the chat. You can speak out if you're okay with that. And also just stop me whenever you need. And if you wanted to come onto screen but not be recorded, I can pause the recording. Just let me know. But further, sort of expanding that philosophy in keeping with the slides rather than my own ad-libbing, is that we're not going to give you everything today. We can't. It's too big. I'm still learning. There's statistics. There's geospatial visualizations, visualizations in charts. There's just all sorts of things you can do with R, which makes it fascinating. But what we're going to start today is like in the agile way of thinking, which I don't know a lot about, but this is what this representation is. You're looking to get the minimal viable product, which is just starting out. You start out with the skateboard and then you improve it a little bit and then you add some pedals to it and then you add a little bit more and then you add a little bit more. And you'll know that you're on the right track with this coding when you have something working, but you instantly want something a bit more. Well, I've got it looking like this, but I want to do this to solve this problem. That is learning R. And there'll be lots of questions. And that's where we're going towards. We're heading towards the car, but we're not going to do that today. This is starting out. Oh, there you go. I've already said the piece. I'm ahead of myself. This is a relaxed and informal workshop, I hope. The slides and the code are all available in that kind of context of reproducibility and collaboration. The slides themselves came from PDFs that were created 3 years ago. I've created them in this interactive format of HTML using a package called Sharingham. And then other colleagues have then extended it and added in the SQL database connection slides as well. So this is a constantly evolving thing because we work better when we all contribute. It just makes life so amazing. So my hope for this is that you'll go away and you will learn your bit of R, and then I will learn from you, as I'm sure I will do. So that's the philosophy, my philosophy as well, added in there. And just reinforcing that we probably won't cover everything today. And don't worry if you retain only a few bits. It's an ongoing process. It's a journey. Let's begin. Well, you've done a great job getting started this morning, either on laptops and PCs or the cloud. I'm going to kind of introduce some of the language, and you might have already heard this because of coming onto this course or hearing people talk about it. They talk about R and RStudio and what's the difference and what do I need when I go to my IT department, what am I actually asking them to install? So R is the programming language that underpins RStudio. RStudio is like I forget what the IDE stands for. It's an IDE. It sits on top of the R. It won't run unless you've got the R program underneath it. So if you were to go to your IT department, if you're working within a public sector organization or any other organization, to be fair, you need to ask for R and RStudio. And although it says improve your programming experience, it's the RStudio that improves it. R's been here from the very beginning and it's being updated, but it's the RStudio sort of overlays it. And just to take that analogy into an analogy, rather, we're looking at R, which is like the sports car. Well, it's not even a sports car. This is like pared down sports car. It's the speed and the efficiency. It's very raw, I guess, in that regard, like this vehicle that we can see on the screen. It doesn't even have sides or a roof, does this? It will go very fast. It's very powerful. But our studio in the car context, it's more like a modern, comfortable car where it's got all of the things set out. You can lay it out for comfort, for ease, just so that you just press buttons and things. In that analogy, that's where RStudio sits. RStudio is in itself also being added to, and there are a few kind of features that I need to sort of write about or kind of share in a different context, I think. So there's a lot in there. I'll show you a few things today to get started as part of the course philosophy, but there are many things that are still being worked on to make life easier. I think in terms of accessibility, just to bear in mind that RStudio, as I've seen from other people commenting on it, is not particularly good for those with visual impairment. There are things to make it more accessible for those with some visual impairments, but I think some people will still use RStudio because it's more accessible to them, or did I say RStudio? I mean R, because it's more accessible, or they just prefer it. So it's about your own preference. But you will find that I do this, and many other people do, that we conflate the two. So R becomes RStudio. So we'll say we're opening R, and really what we're doing is RStudio. It's just one of those language things that I think they're becoming synonymous with each other. So everybody, I think, is, I hope, already they've got some sort of RStudio open either on their machine or on the cloud. And when I was showing people on the cloud, I hopefully got you to seeing this kind of structure where you've got three windows. You won't have as much code in that window if you were following me on the cloud. Don't worry about that. It doesn't have to be exact, but what you're looking for is to have the console on the left, taking up the left of the screen. I'm going to share my screen now. So if I go into my workspace, and this will probably make it a bit small for those who are on laptops or perhaps watching this on YouTube later. So on the left of the screen, upgrade. Oh, I'm on the wrong workspace. That's why. Oh dear. Excuse me while I find where I'm supposed to be. I have a lot of workspaces and I'm supposed to be, where am I supposed to be? Oops, sorry, I think I can see everybody's things there, sorry. So on the left of your screen, you should just have one console which takes up the RStudio screen. And on the left, I have two things. One on the top says environment, which is the tab, the first tab, and in the bottom right-hand corner, I just realized you want that. In the bottom right-hand corner, you'll have all the files that are listed here. Okay, so when we start, you can use this console section. You can code directly into it. So I'm just going to type this out as it says in the slide, pi times two, and then enter. And then you get a number. Now I have actually done this where I've just used it as a glorified calculator. It does some, you know, like three times two, don't need to type that, but you can just use it as you would do for any calculation. I'm gonna do this one, 37 divided by 12, which is a bit more tricky to do in your head, certainly for mine. And you get your response within there, but it says there's a better way in here. And that's because you don't keep it. It's just everything goes to the console. So any coding that you do in any script, if you get somebody else's script, then you run that. Like these are bits of language and terminology that we'll use throughout the course. It all goes to the console. It's run once, but it's not kept or saved anywhere. So to create a script where we would write things, which is more familiar for those who are using, say, SQL, we can do that a number of ways, as you can do with Microsoft products. There are shortcut keys, there are two or three different areas within your menus to start new files. So if you go to File and then New File, you'll get this long list of things that you can open in scripts. The one that we'll be using is the R script, which is right at the top. Now in the cloud, it's got a shortcut key, which is a little bit longer than the PC because you're in a browser. I quite prefer to use this other button, which is a green button with a white cross in it. And if you click on the arrow that's next to it, you get a shortened version of that long file list. And in there, you've got at the top the R script again, or the shortcut key that you can use. Now, I use shortcut keys a lot, but when I'm on the browser, I'm just going to use the drop-down menu because I always open up the wrong thing. I'll hope I'll remember that as I go along. So if everybody can follow doing that and open up a new script, you'll then get four quadrants. Your RStudio becomes four spaces. There are ways of moving it around. This is kind of like the standard that people use, but I think it's in Vue. You can move your panes around. So there's a lot of flexibility on how you read it and where you set up things. You can have three columns as well now, and I won't do that because it will make it really, really small, but there's a lot of functionality that you can do about where you place things. These two names are the kind of key points when we're looking at the RStudio panes. You've got the editor at the top and the console at the bottom. In the editor at the top, most of the shortcut keys work. So if you're writing something like pi times two, and then I want to undo, I can do control Z and it undoes it. The thing to bear in mind, which I got stuck with because I use shortcut keys a lot, is if you do control Y, it doesn't work, which is what you would use in most other products or programs, but it's control shift and Y to bring it back. And it doesn't work on the cloud either, actually. Is it control shift Z? That's why. Control shift Z. If I read the slide, I would follow my own advice. That's very useful to know because I know for a few months after I was learning R, I tried to avoid having to redo because I didn't know what the shortcut key was. Autocomplete is also available within this editor section. We'll see that as we're typing some other code. that can be very helpful when things are long, or it's just very useful to see things when it autocomplete is quite useful generally. And as I said before, everything then goes to the console when you run it. So you'll see things repeated from up here down in the bottom. To run that line of code, I'm going to do pi times 3 on this occasion so you can see it. You need your cursor somewhere in the code. Now, unlike those who use SQL, you have to highlight the entire thing that you're running. When you're in R, it's broken by the line. So you just need to be somewhere in your code for the most part, usually at the top line so that you get past some of the kind of foibles for some packages. And then either run using a button if you prefer buttons. I will just make this bigger so that people can see. There's a button here that says run. I'm not entirely sure what's on that actual button, but if I hover over it, it says run the current line or section, or you can use control and enter. So if I use control and enter, which we will do a lot of, you can see it repeats down here what the code was I ran and then the answer. Oh, sorry, my screen disappeared. It'll be back. My link's a bit dodgy. As you can do in most scripted languages, you need comments. They're very useful. It's very useful to write these comments to yourself, be verbose, write as much as you need, particularly in those first forays into learning the learning a language. And if you are doing that in R, it's a hash. This is a comment. And it comes out, it's not very clear in this particular setup, but it comes out as green. And just see if you can see it. You'll see it better when we change some of the settings in a second. But the pi bit is in black, the multiplication is black, and the number is blue. So there's color coordination in there as well that can be quite useful to highlight to yourself what you're writing. So when you're doing the comments, they come out as green. And when I run that, I'll do control and enter. It doesn't run anything. In fact, I don't think it even runs it. Oh, it does run something, but it doesn't come out. Oh, it says this is a comment, but it doesn't run anything. So it reads it, but it doesn't do anything with it. So it doesn't break your code. Comment frequently. Eventually, you will not need so many comments, but don't feel bad about writing it to your future self or to your colleagues in your code. Now, this is when I need to change the settings, which will make things a bit clearer in what is highlighted in the script. And this is very, very useful in RStudio. So if you go to Tools and General Options, I think, is on the cloud. It might just be Options if you're on your PC. It's the last option in the menu. You get... Excuse me. You get a wizard that crops up. And the first thing that people are always advised to do when using RStudio is to untick this workspace section here, restore R.R data. It's a strange thing that everybody is suggested. It's a suggestion that everybody does, but it's not default because there's a reason why it's not default here. I think they started it a long, long time ago, and to revert could change people's way of working. This is what they say in the default. You could read about it if you need more information. I was just curious, so I found this link and then I put it into the slide. What it's referring to is that when you run things, do things to your data frames, or let's call them tables if people are familiar in SQL and Excel, and then you go away from your PC and come back, they'll still be there if it's ticked. Now, that might be what you want, but generally what you need to have frequently set is a clean workspace, so that if you've changed something and then refer to that changed thing, but then delete the code that you used, and I have done that, it doesn't work when you clear everything out. So if you've got lots of things in your RStudio that you've created, and then you share that code with somebody else, it may not run if they don't have all that code still. So it's just good practice. So that when you leave your machine, you shut down RStudio, even not leave your machine necessarily, it clears everything out. It just reverts back to default. Default as in clearing everything out, not in default settings that we're going to change next. You don't have to do it, as I say. It's a preference. One of the things I am going to do now is change the appearance, and I'm going to change it, but if it's not suitable for anybody, please just drop me a note in the chat and I can change that back. Lots of people, and I particularly like dark mode. So there's a lot of options here. And I'm going to use tomorrow night, which you can see the kind of preview here. It changes the background screen to black. There are some other ones just to highlight. I think it's solarized light, which has a yellow background. That's quite useful for ease on your eyes generally. I use this in SQL. This also, I've been told, really useful for people with dyslexia because it changes the color of the text. I think it just helps with the text. But there's a lot of options. You can even have it looking like SQL Server. But I find that a bit confusing. I think I'll just stick with tomorrow night. I'm going to make the font size bigger so that you can actually now see in the background, hopefully. It's a little bit bigger so you can see the differences in the color. Now my comment has gone gray, but you can see that the numbers are orange. There are some other accessibility things. There's a whole section here on accessibility, so it's worth having a look in there for some other options that might make things easier for you. And those will be retained every time you shut down RStudio and open it. It will be this, and actually you might see that later. If I use my desktop, it keeps reverting back to my dark mode when I go through things. One of the language bits of language that you all have heard and you probably will have read if you looked at the pre-work is this word packages. So I'll just give you a quick explanation about what we mean by that. So packages are like the apps on your phone. What we need to do quite often is to extend the capabilities of basic R, which is base R, which has come through using R. You can use base R as well in RStudio. And it's a very powerful programming language, but people have built upon it with some functions and some other things that they do, and then built on that again. And the packages have, well, let me just show you. Well, not quite that, the slide I'm going to. Packages are like apps on your phone. So that you download them once from your app stores, and then you open your app, and you download once and you can open frequently. And that kind of analogy is the same for the packages within R and RStudio. You download once what you require and you open repeatedly. A couple of things to mention for the libraries, particularly for people who are using shared network spaces or shared computers, but not shared profiles, for example, is your packages will be downloaded to your own file. So if you download some files onto your network drive, if you're on a network and a work computer, it will go to your own folder. So your colleague, when they come along, they'll need to download the same packages. So you must bear that in mind if you have restrictions with packages and installations, if you're working with IT that does it for you. I'm just thinking, nope, that's fine. I think that's it. I need to just cover. Oh, yeah, there you go. I'm jumping ahead. So what we need to do, so if you're on your own computer, there's no issue with that. If it's a personal computer, other people can come to it and just find it in a central location. Okay. And the other thing to bear in mind for those who with very restrictive IT systems, a lot of these packages can be found, I mean, say a lot, there's 17,000, that's a phenomenal amount of packages that have gone through a service called CRAN, which is Comprehensive Archive Network. I'm glad I've written that out because I never remember it. People refer to this always as CRAN. So there are all sorts of packages on there. Pretty much anything that you're working with, if you want to import it into R, if it's MATLAB or SPSS or Excel or workbooks, there'll be a package and it will probably be on CRAN. So you can get those downloaded by going to CRAN and then installing it from there, which is where we're going to get the packages that we're going to do in a second. But there are other ways to get the packages, and I wouldn't really dismiss getting them from GitHub. It's a little bit upsetting, not upsetting, but it's a bit restrictive when IT systems don't allow that, because there's a lot of packages that say even NHS-R community people have done for our own trusts that we put on our GitHub, but we don't share on CRAN either because they're still in development or because they're being, you know, they might just be data downloads, which that changes frequently. We've got a few projects, for example, or packages, sorry, must use the right terminology, a few packages through NHS-R community that are available through GitHub and a couple that are available through CRAN. So we use both. So if they're in development, as I say, we keep them on GitHub. So that's very useful. You go to people's GitHub site and get the latest development they're doing. But the ones we're going to use today are on CRAN. They're the most well-renowned. We're going to use Tidyverse, which is interesting because it's a package of packages. It kind of comes back to that whole Facebook thing that people might have heard recently. There's a lot of Verse being used, and in this regard Tidyverse is a collection of packages maintained through RStudio and RStudio people, and they all have the same underlying principle. So they work well together. And I think the principle is if one changes, they make sure all the other packages work in line with it. They provide simple tools within those packages, enough to get you started, I'd say, with a consistent structure to help solve complex problems. So the tidyverse is a couple of packages, more than we've got listed here, but we're going to be using these three, which is ggplot2 for data visualizations, dplyr, which is for data manipulation, and readr for getting CSV files into RStudio to do things with. They're all bundled up into one package, which for those on the cloud has already been installed, and for those on their PCs and laptops, hopefully you've already got it started, but I can show you the code as we go along to get that. It takes a little bit longer because you're doing to load, this is to install, into, not load, I get the wrong words, to install onto your PC because there's a lot in there. And you run it by, it doesn't say in there, but I'll put it into the code. Let me do it here, actually. You run it by typing install packages. Tidyverse. Now, I've written it badly there, I've just realized, sorry. It has to have quotation marks around it when you're installing. I'll just put that into the chat so that people can use that if they need it. It's already on the cloud, so you don't need to do that, just to warn you. When you use it, and I will say in a second, so we're loading it, we write tidyverse, and it doesn't need to be in quotation marks, and I'll put that one into the chat. So just to recap, because I think I just sort of babbled over that, install packages, when you do it once, like you do for the app on your phone, it has quotation marks around the package because you're passing through characters, string, that kind of thing. But when you're loading it, which you may do repeatedly in different scripts, different parts of your work within R, you don't need those quotation marks. This is the bit that you see in here in the text that you see in the slide. It's more colorful on my screen. It's telling you, which is quite nice, what's been attached. So there are 8 packages that get installed, not installed, loaded. And there are conflicts within there. So there are functions in there between 2 packages, which are the same name. And what it's saying here, which is just being quite helpful, is that the filter is in dplyr and it's also in a stats package, but the dplyr takes precedence over the stats package. We're not going to use that one today, the stats package, but it just sort of warns you that if you use this and you don't say which package it is that you're requiring, we're going to default to dplyr. On my own computer, because this is what happens, I get warnings telling me things were built in the version this, that, and the other. You don't get that on the cloud because the cloud is like the most up-to-date that we've got. So just to say this is a warning message, it still works. It's not an error. It's just telling you some information about the version that you've got. Now, you may have that depending on how you're working on your laptops and your PCs because we've got various different levels of R in RStudio. And hopefully everybody should have Tidyverse loaded.
Hey Zoe, yep. Sorry to interrupt, but can
no, that's fine.
When we were breaking for lunch, there was a question in the chat about that.
When we're what?
Breaking for lunch.
Oh, breaking for lunch. If we carry on and do well, probably around 12-ish. I think it's as soon as I hit a natural break like this at the end, but it's often around 12 and then I get very hungry.
Yes.
And I tend to ask around 12 how people feel. You know, whether to carry on. And by that point, everyone's like, lunch, give me lunch. Now I'm at a natural break at the moment. So I think I will suggest a quick, like 2-3 minute break. Well, we're at a nice point here where it's 25 to 11. So if we come back at, I'm just trying to carry on, add 5 minutes. So 5 minutes break? No, let's do 3 minutes. Let's keep you on your toes. Have a 3 minute break to, have a bit of a stretch, walk around, and then come back because we're going to go on to using RStudio projects. So 3 minutes, don't worry if you're making a cup of tea and it's a bit later, it's just me talking. I'm going to put it on mute. I've got somebody who's just asked me something in the chat, but I'll do that. Oh, sorry, Helen, yes. Sorry, you just messaged me directly. If you want to share your screen, because you're on the cloud, you've got a bit of an issue. I will just check, see if I can. Am I not sharing? I'm not sharing. I stopped at all. Hang on. Yes, you should be able to share your screen, Helen, if you want to. I'll just pause.
I'm trying.
Okay, Helen, I've paused the share. So okay. Did you want to share your screen? You've got a problem with the cloud.
I'm just trying to do it just now.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, it's a bit loud, but it's okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
don't worry. I paused the share, so it's not on there. So, you know, the what's not share? The recording. I paused the recording.
It just says I cannot share, start screen share while the other participant is sharing.
Try that. I've changed my settings. Okay. Lovely Zoom. It's got about 3 or 4 settings for everything.
I think I'm trying to remember which one I'm on.
Don't worry. Okay. Oh, okay. So you've written load tidyverse. That's what you need actually is library. So keep removing it all. Keep going back. Backspace. That's it. And type library. Oh, sorry, I'm making it over. Yeah. And then just a bracket. I'm not sure if that will work with the space. Try it. I've never done that. I've always had it next to it. I'm quite intrigued to know if that will work. And then do control and enter control and enter. If you like shortcut keys. It should run.
Didn't work with the, didn't like the control and enter.
Okay. I think your screen, I can't see. I think it's removed it, hasn't it? Let me just see. You should have a button where you can run it, but I'm not seeing it on your screen.
Seeing it either. That's what I was skipping.
So you know where the line between your panels is? So you've got this kind of like long line. If you put your mouse over it, you should get like a thing that you can click and drag it. So what I'm trying to do is, no, the other way. No. So move your mouse to the right. That's it. That's it. Now click. Oh, no, you've gone back to the right. Go back to left. Keep going left, slightly. Stop. You see where it goes? Yep. And then click with your left and then drag. That's it. Release. No, it's still not showing. Okay. Let me just see what the thing is. I have to just find the menu. This is really testing my menu work now. So it's, I think, file. Where would it be? So what do you get an error when you do control and enter?
I don't get anything. So can you...
Could you just go onto a new line and do pi times 2? Oh, yeah, it's asterisk. Yeah, that's it, 2. And then do control and enter. You need to be on the line itself, though, to run it. That's it.
No.
Control and enter. And it's not doing anything at all.
Working.
Oh, okay.
But if you try typing it directly in the console, does it let you just enter that?
You can do, but also if it's in code, if you go to that drop-down menu.
Oh, you're in the R history file.
Oh, I see. Well spotted.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, nice.
Thank you. It was someone in the chat.
If you highlight all of that and copy it. Oh, you're just deleting it. I don't know how you got to R history file. That's cool. But what happens when you run all your code, it goes into the R history, so you can find it again. But I think you've opened it, and it needs to be in the untitled one.
Okay, so,
well spotted. I would shut down that .R history. That's it. It does. There you go. You can see where it says you got that auto correct now.
Okay, so library.
Yeah. You need to click in it and then type again because it's not. There you go. And then it will fill in for you. So if you do the enter, it will just do the brackets now. There you go. Yeah, there we go. And then do control and enter. Yeah, that's why. Well spotted to that person. I'm going to take the screen back so that you're fine. And I'm just going to have a quick walk around myself. If I can get my screen, I don't know where I'm doing it. Yes. And share.